Guys, welcome back to another lecture of Rental Paathshala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And this video is a continuation of the Express Revision course for Periodontics. And today's video will be covering the restorative and the endodontic part of the periodic dentistry. And before we get started, make sure you subscribe to the channel and click on the bell icon so that you don't miss any of our future videos. And notes of this particular video lecture will be provided in the description below. So let's get started with the restorative and the endodontic part. First of all, the restorative material we have is the amalgam and the amalgam alloys. So depending on the alloy particle size and the shape of the particle, we have different kind of amalgam alloys. One is the lathicut alloys, another one are the spherical alloys. And we have admixed alloys. So guys, what's the difference between the lathicut and the spherical alloys? So the particles of the lathicut are spherical, the spherical are the particles are the spherical in, as the name suggests, the spherical alloys, the particles of the spherical alloys are spherical in shape. So they are manufactured by the atomization of the molten alloy, while on the other hand, the particles of the lathicut alloys are very irregular. And this is the reason that they require more mercury for making this restorative material. So they are manufactured by milling and annealed ingot of the alloy. So we take a piece of the alloy and then we heat it in the molten state. So this is how we make this alloy. So the lathicut alloy, it is less plastic, it resists more condensation pressure, and the most important thing is that it requires more mercury, and therefore it has got inferior properties. So here comes the spherical alloys, which are spherical in shape, they are not irregular like the lathicut, and they require less mercury. So that is the reason that they have got the better properties, they have enhanced properties. So these are more plastic, and we can establish a proximal contour well in the spherical alloys. So next classification is based on the copper or the zinc content. So copper is added, guys, to increase the hardness, to increase the strength of an alloy. So we have the low copper. The low copper alloys, guys, are the traditional alloys. So these are the particular alloys which contain less than 6% of the copper content. So basically 2 to 6% of the copper. Then we have the high copper alloys. So the high copper alloys are the alloys which has got the copper content more than 6%. So that is 13% of the copper is present in the high copper alloys. So in the high copper alloys, again we have the admixed kind or the unicompositional. That means the single composition. Then based on the zinc content, we have zinc containing alloys. These are the alloys which contain the zinc. So zinc containing alloys, they have the they have zinc in it. So that is when there is more than 0.01% of the zinc. If it is present, we call it the zinc containing alloy, or we have the zinc free alloys. That means if the zinc content in the alloy is less than 0.01% of the zinc, we call it the zinc free alloys. So based on the addition of the noble metals, we have generations. So the first one is the original peritactic alloy. That means the silver tin alloy, right? So we call it three parts of the silver and one part of the tin. So we have three parts of the silver. So let's write silver instead. Three parts of the silver. Plus, guys, we have one part of the tin. So this is the original peritactic alloy. The second generation alloys, the first generation plus we have copper also in it. So up to 4% we have copper, plus we have zinc also up to 1%. So these are basically the zinc containing and the copper containing alloys. Third generation is, guys, the first generation, if you remember, it is a silver tin, right? Just the silver tin alloy. The third generation is, instead of silver tin, now it is silver copper alloy. So it is silver copper eutectic alloy. Fourth generation is when it is alloyed with copper or we have the silver tin. So when the silver tin is up to 29%, so basically tin in the silver tin is 29% and we have copper along with that, so it becomes the fourth generation. Fifth generation is when we have silver, copper and tin. So along with that, when we add the indium, that makes it fifth generation. The sixth generation is when in that you add palladium. So when there is palladium plus we have the silver copper, so silver copper eutectic, that is the third generation, right? So eutectic, so this is the third generation. If you remember, third generation is silver copper. See, this is the silver copper. First generation, if you remember, that is the silver tin, which is basically our original peritectic alloy. So guys, what happens in the alloy, we add the mercury, and because there are so many toxic effects of the mercury, so this led the researcher to think about the mercury free alloys. So the in the market there comes the material gallium. So gallium is a alloy which cuts down the toxic effect of the mercury. So gallium is like, instead of the mercury alloys, we think of the mercury free alloys, so we have a gallium alloy, so which is a mercury free. So in the amalgam guys, instead of mercury there is a gallium. The properties in fact of the silver amalgam, so see, silver amalgam is silver alloy plus we add mercury in it, so that becomes the silver amalgam. The properties of this gallium is greater than or equal to the silver amalgam alloys. So basically the creep values of this gallium alloy is lesser, and also we can polish it at the same day. And the best property about this gallium alloy is that after mixing, once you put it in the cavity, so after mixing, suppose you have mixed this gallium alloy, put it inside, so it has got some expansion, and because of that it provides a good seal at the margin. So it has got the good marginal seal which is seen with this gallium alloy. So it provides a good marginal seal also, and it cuts down all the toxic effects of the mercury. So next we'll be talking about only the high yielding points. Guys, this is an express revision course, we're only talking about the high yielding points. So we have glass and omer cement. So what is the setting reaction that is asked frequently in the exams? For a normal conventional GIC, there is an acid base reaction. One acid is there, base is there, and the reaction, the setting reaction is by the acid base reaction. Then guys, we have the resin GIC. So resin modified GIC we call it. Since there is a resin in that GIC, so it contains 5% of the resin in the conventional GIC, it is known as the resin modified GIC. It is also known as the hybrid ionomer, or it is also known as the resinomer or polyacid modified resins. So polyacid modified resins, all are the same name for the resin modified GIC, modified resins. So basically it contains resins. Since it contain resin, the main setting reaction, I mean the essential setting reaction guys, is the acid base reaction. Definitely acid base reaction will be there because there is a conventional GIC. Along with that, because there is a resin component, we have talked about, there is 5% resin matrix which is added to modify the liquid component of the GIC. So because of that, the resin component, it can be activated by the light, chemical, or either it can be activated by both of them. So there is an ion exchange system is not used in this. So there is a polymerization reaction because of the resin. And we all know that in the dental materials, we know that the resin sets with a polymerization reaction. We all study that resin, we have a polymerization shrinkage. So all these things, we know that, right? Then comes, guys, the polyacid modified resin, which is also known as the compomer. So polyacid modified resins, they do not contain water. Instead of that, they have some special component, essential component of the GIC. So in the compomer, we see that there is an acid-base reaction, but this reaction doesn't happen in the dark. So this you have to remember it. So next one, we have the dentin bonding agents. So we have 7 generation of the dentin bonding agent. First generation is when there is a chelation which happens with the calcium of the tooth. So guys, what happens in the first generation, there is a metal. Let's write it here. So there is a metal. So this metal, it forms the chelates, right? So like that, it forms the chelate. The same kind of structure we see in the tetracycline, the same kind of chelation happens in the GIC as well. So first generation bonding agent is when there is a chelation which happens with the tooth. So the first generation bonding agent are the surface active comonomer. Then we have the second generation. So second generation, first is the chelation happens. Second is when it forms the ionic bond, guys. So here is the chelation, right? The second one is when it forms the ionic bond. So it forms the ionic bond with the dentine, with the calcium which is present in the dentine. So tooth contains the calcium and it forms the bond with the calcium. So say calcium is positive, right? When it makes a bond with a negative ion, so plus minus and positive negative ion is when it forms a ionic bond. We call it the second generation. So we have the halophosphoric esters of bis-GMA and HEMA. Next we have is the third generation. So guys, third generation, there is a concept of the smear layer. So there is partial removal or the modification of the smear layer. Modification, or we can say removal of the smear layer. Of the smear layer. So say suppose we have the dentinal tubules like this. So guys, what happens? The smear layer is removed. So there is a smear layer which is removal. I mean, which is seen with the acid. First of all, we apply the acid, which is etching. We say it. The first step is the etching. So with the help of acid, we take the phosphoric acid. After that, we rinse it. Then guys, we see that there are etched tubules like this. So suppose previously there was like this. Now we see that there are etched tubules like this. So there is a porosity which is created in the dentinal tubules. So there are exposed collagen because of the removal of the smear layer. And then we add the primer or adhesive. Then we add the composite. So this is the concept of the smear layer. So this is how the composite binds. So we have a hybrid layer in this concept. So this is a hybrid layer. Then we have the dentinal adhesives. So say these are the adhesive layer. Then we have top of that composite. So this is how the composite binds in the upper layer. So basically, there is a hybrid layer concept which is seen at the third generation. So guys, fourth generation, there is a complete removal of the smear layer. Let's write complete removal of the smear layer. And the three-step bonding technique we see. So basically the hybrid layer, which is 2 to 4 micrometer deep, is formed. We see that there is a hybrid layer. So there is conditioning in this step. We see that there is conditioning. Then we apply the primer. and we also see that there is a bonding agent. So all these three steps are seen at the fourth generation. So we do the etching, then we rinse it, then we apply the primer, adhesive, and then composite. So all the steps, three steps are seen at the fourth generation. Then we have, guys, the fifth generation, which is the one bottle system. So guys, this fifth generation is what do we use in our clinics. We have an etchant. So guys, we have an etchant. This is etchant. Plus we have a bonding agent. So we have a bonding agent. So we have E plus B in this one bottle. Right. So E plus B is we have an etchant and we have a bonding agent. And this is a total etch. So that means in the fifth generation, we have a combination of the primer and the bonding agent. And that is why it is known as the single system adhesive. So one bottle system you can say, or single system you can say, single system adhesive. That means you are going to apply the etchant, then you are going to wash it, and then, so first of all, applying the etchant is going to create the smear layer. Then guys, you are going to rinse it, and then you are going to apply this bonding agent. So it composes of the primer and adhesive. So next one, we have the sixth one, which is the self etchant primer. Self etching adhesive, or you can say self etchant primer. So guys, in the sixth generation, there is no requirement of the rinsing. So there is no rinsing because etchant is combined with the primer. So we have etchant and primer in one bottle, plus we have adhesive. So, and then we cure it. So basically, etchant and bonding agent is there. So we don't have to rinse it. First of all, you apply the etchant and primer combination. So the self-etchant primer, that is going to create a smear layer, guys. But this smear layer is actually filled with the primer. So there is no requirement for the rinsing. And on the top of that, we just add the adhesive. So this is the sixth generation, which removes the rinsing part. Then comes the seventh generation, guys, which is all in one. So everything is there in just in the one bottle, all in one. So these are about the dentin bonding agent. First one we have talked is about the chelation. Second one is the ionic bond. Third generation is the partial removal of the smear layer. Then we have the complete removal of the smear layer, in that we have the three bottle system. We have the conditioner, primer and the bonding agent. Then we have combination of the primer and the bonding agent, which we call it the single system adhesive, or we can say the one bottle system. So basically one bottle is there, that's it. We apply etchant, then rinse it, and then the whatever is there in the bottle, we put it. So that is the combination of the bonding agent. So we have in that system, so that is the single system adhesive. And then sixth generation is etchant and bonding agent. So that removes the part of the rinsing part. So we have the etchant plus primer in one and adhesive in the another one. So seventh generation is all in one. Now guys, earlier what used to happen is, what used to be there is that, see, suppose this is an occlusal surface, okay? So if you are doing a prophylactic, so if you want, if there are deep fissures are present, deep pits are present, so all these susceptible fissures to the caries, say suppose these are very deep, right? So what used to happen is, previously we used to prepare a shallow class 1 cavity. So not deep one, just the shallow class 1. So say suppose like this, like very shallow. So earlier we used to put amalgam here. Say we are going to put amalgam here, so that there is no caries. This is known as prophylactic odontomy. That means we are removing, we are making this class 1, guys. So this class 1, shallow class 1 cavity preparation is known as prophylactic odontomy. That means for the prophylaxis, we are removing the crown. So odontomy means removal of the enamel. So we are removing the enamel for the prophylaxis so that there is no caries. We know that these like molars are very susceptible to caries. So we make a shallow minimal class 1 cavity, and then we used to fill it with the amalgam previously. Now we fill it with the fissure sealants. So pit and fissure sealants we fill. Then we have composites. We have thermal activating, that means the one which are activated by the heat. So the activator in these are the heat, right? The initiator is the benzoyl peroxide. Then we have the chemical activation, in which the polymerization starts by the chemical reaction. So the activator and the chemical activator are the tertiary amines. The initiator is still the benzoyl peroxide. Then we have the light activation, and that we have visible light, or there can be UV light activation also visible. We have the blue light, right? So the activation is the diketones, and the initiator is the camphoroquinone in this. Then guys, we have different categories of the composite. We have the conventional, then small particle filled composite, then microfield composite, and the hybrid composite. So the particle size varies. So we'll be dealing all these particle size in micrometer. What is the particle size and how much is the filler percentage? So the conventional one, the particle size is the biggest, which is 8 to 12 micrometer, and the filler content is again high, 75 to 80%. The hybrid, we have almost the same filler content, which is 70 to 80%, but here the particle size is the least. So the particle size is 0.06 to 1 micrometer of the particle size. Then we have the small particle fill composite, in which the particle size is 7 to 5 micrometers, and again, and same goes for the percentage. So 5 we have 55 to 7 we have 70% filler. Then the microfield, which is the particle size is 0.04 to 0.4 micrometers, and the filler is again percentage is very small, 35 to 60% of the filler. Then guys, we have rubber dam. So rubber dam is basically a sheet of the latex, sheet of the rubber. So that is the reason it is not used in patients who are allergic to the latex. So rubber dam is a latex sheet which is used to isolate the isolate the teeth. So we place this sheet and we put a clamp on the teeth. So we have only this teeth which is there. Rest of the mouth is covered with a rubber dam. So that is the reason that it is used for isolating the teeth, and it was first given by Barnum. So, which is important for our exams viewpoint. So, it is a sheet which is used to prevent the aspiration of the foreign objects. See, this is a quite a complicated situation when there is any instrument which is dental instrument which is taken or swallowed by the patient. So, that becomes a critical situation. So, if we use this rubber dam, nothing can go inside. So it prevents the aspiration of the foreign object, and also it maintains a clean field, visible field. So only because the tooth which we are working, it is only visible to us, it is only isolated. So it also retract the soft tissues, it protect the soft tissues, again it help to reduce the cross contamination. Also there are psychological benefits to the patient as well, and the properties of the restorative material are improved, such as we are using GIC or composite, wherein we do not want any saliva contamination. So in all these cases, it provides saliva control, it provides the protection, and also it saves us time. So it is useful in maintaining a clean field. So let's write maintaining a clean field. So guys, where this rubber dam is contraindicated, it is very important, because again this can be asked as a question. So in case if the patient are allergic to latex, definitely it cannot be used. In case wherein we cannot put a clamp, say suppose a recently erupted tooth or a still erupting teeth. So a recently erupted tooth or a tooth is still erupting, because it cannot hold the clamp, it cannot retain a clamp, then in case if there is a ortho treatment, so in case suppose if there is a fixed orthodontic treatment, orthodontic therapy, if a person is undergoing, so in that case we cannot put the rubber dam, or in case a child is having a upper respiratory tract infection, say upper respiratory tract infection, or any congestion to the nasal passage, or we can say any nasal obstruction, we cannot put this. Now we have some clamps, different type of clamps which are used in different teeth. So let's talk about the teeth and the ivory. Which ivory clamp we are going to talk about? So start guys from the primary incisors and canine. We have the zero ivory clamp, then the first molar and the first, say, primary molar and the permanent canine. Then we have two. Then we have 2 and 2A. Then the secondary molar, primary teeth. We have the 3 ivory. Then guys, a partially erupted. Permanent molar. For a partially erupted, we have 8A, but for a fully erupted, permanent molar, we have 8 ivory number. So this is the sequence. Again, like these are the numbers you can remember. The rubber dam is available in various thickness. So based on the thickness of the rubber dam, we can classify the rubber dam sheets into a thin sheet, a medium sheet, then we have a heavy sheet, then we have extra heavy sheet, then we have special heavy also. So many heavy. So we have thin, medium, heavy, extra heavy and special heavy. So what we have to do is we have to add 0.05 mm into each. So addition of 0.5 mm starting with a 0.15 mm. So if you add 0.05 into 1.5, that will become 0.20 mm, right? So let's remove this. Then if you add 0.05 into 0.20 mein, that will become 0.25 mm. So if you add 0.05 into 0.25 mm, that will become 0.30 mm. So if you add 0.05 mm into 0.30, it will become 0.35 mm. So these are the thickness of the sheets based on the, we have thin sheet, medium, heavy, extra heavy and special heavy. So heavy and extra heavy are आर यूज फॉर द रिस्टोरेटिव प्रोसीजर्स बिकॉज दीज आर थिक शीट्स गाइज. मीडियम वन इज एन आइडियल फॉर एंडोडोंटिक प्रोसीजर, एंडोडोंटिक थेरेपी. सी रिट्रैक्ट अ थिक शीट इज ईजियर, आई मीन इट्स बेटर देन द थिन वन, बट अगेन हैवी इज डिफिकल्ट टू प्लेस राइट. सो अ मीडियम वन इज काइंड ऑफ एन आइडियल और अप्रोप्रिएट फॉर एंडोडोंटिक थेरेपीज बिकॉज इट इज ईजी टू प्लेस देन हैवियर एंड इट इज it retracts better than the thin one, so it is an ideal for the endodontic therapies. So guys, let's talk about the frames as well. So first one we have here is a U-shaped frame, right, which you have seen most commonly using with the rubber dam. So this is basically a plastic frame which is known as starlight visi frame. So it is a plastic frame, so because of its shape it exerts less tension or pressure on the dam. It is very easier to use. So next frame you can see here is the Nygaard Ottsby frame. So Nygaard Ottsby frame, this frame guys, you can see here it is a curved frame. So the benefit of using this curved frame is that it doesn't require the absorbent napkin. So basically it stands away from the face. So it is used for taking radiographs of molars. It is a curved frame. Next one here is basically an articulated frame, guys. Articulated frame. So this frame is Lee Cadry articulate rubber dam. So basically this is the recent or newest kind of the frame. So guys, this frame, as you can see here, this is a hinge. So this is a hinge. So it can be folded like this. So it can go like this and it can be folded. Like this, guys. So it can be folded. So there is a hinge which is there in the middle, which is to allow the folding back. So it is allow easier access to place the radiographic film. So radiographic film placements becomes easier because of this hinge which is present in the middle of the frame. So basically it is used for the endodontic radiographs procedure and all. So this is about the few important points regarding the rubber dam. So let's discuss few important points regarding the cavity preparation in the primary teeth now. Cavity preparation, guys, in the primary teeth is different from the permanent teeth because of the pattern of the primary teeth. Primary teeth are much smaller, they have thin enamel. So because of the thickness of the enamel, so thickness of the enamel for primary it is 1 mm, for permanent it is much more. For permanent it is like somewhere 2 to 3 millimeters. Then guys, so many things, and even the endodontic treatment also varies because of the root. Because see, these are a kind of a primary teeth like this. So the primary teeth actually are like this, very divergent, furcation is very close to the CJ, so all these features like this, right? This is the primary teeth. If we see the permanent teeth, guys, the permanent teeth are more like this. So these are like permanent teeth. So permanent teeth. So basically because of the root trunk is different, root trunk is smaller in primary than the permanent teeth. And also guys, in the primary teeth, you know, we see the cervical constriction. So we see that like this, a constriction is there. this constriction is there, which is we call the cervical constriction. So basically they're very small at the bottom. So proximal wall, they diverge gingivally so as to provide a cleansing area. So gingival wall is difficult to achieve if we are talking about the cavity preparation, because the cavity extend to gingivally because there is a cervical constriction. So we have to modify our preparation accordingly. And also the enamel rods, guys, the enamel rods at the gingival area. So at the gingival area, you will find this, these enamel rods are occlusally placed in primary teeth. But enamel rods in the gingival area are basically towards the gingiva in the permanent teeth. So in the permanent teeth, since they are towards gingivally, we have to give the gingival bevel. And enamel rods in primary teeth are occlusally. All these things, guys, we have covered in the periodontic lecture series. So if you want to learn more differences between the primary and the permanent teeth, you can watch the in detail videos, video lecture we have in the playlist. So we have occlusally. One second, guys. In the primary teeth, we have occlusally. So this is the reason that we do not give any gingival bevel in the primary teeth, right? So also the depth of the cavity remains 1.5 millimeter. We have to go 0.5 to 0.5 into the dentine. So this is about the restorative part. Next talk about the endodontic part. In case of pediatric patients. And guys, before starting with the endodontic part, let's cover few more points in the restorative part. Is that the rubber dam in the children, guys, I forgot to tell you. So rubber dam in the children is 5 into 5 inch, but for adults it is 6 into 6. And also the sequence of caries. So that we forgot to cover in the dental caries part. So sequence of caries in the primary teeth we are talking about, guys. So in the primary teeth, the most primary teeth which get affected with the dental caries is the mandibular second molar, right? Then we have the maxillary second molar. Then, guys, we have the mandibular first molar. Then we have the maxillary. I'm sorry. Then we have the maxillary first molar. This is the maxillary first molar. Then we have the mandibular first molar. Then we have the maxillary anterior. And the last one is the mandibular anterior. Now, if you remember which type of caries the mandibular anteriors are spared or are least affected. So we have talked about the nursing bottle caries in the previous part of the lecture series of Express Revision course, that the nursing bottle caries when the is due to prolonged feeding, breastfeeding, or prolonged bottle feeding habit, especially the bottle feeding habit, guys. So if the child is having a prolonged bottle feeding habit and the pacifiers are dipped in the honey and the child sleeps it, so what happens? Because the mandibular anterior are spared because of the protection of the tongue. So tongue is always there in the mandibular incisors, mandibular anterior, so they are spared. Rest of the teeth, the most commonly affected are the maxillary anteriors and the maxillary molars, right? And both the molars, maxillary and the mandibular. So this is the sequence of caries for the primary teeth, guys. And if you see the surfaces, which all surfaces are affected? So the most common surfaces is always the occlusal surface, right? Then we have the interproximal surface in the molars, and then we have the interproximal surfaces in the proximal surfaces in the incisors. So this is the sequence. So guys, when a pediatric patient comes to you and tells you about mild sensitivity, first of all, it is very difficult for a child to understand the difference between the sensitivity and the pain. So if the child is having a low threshold for a pain, then the mild sensitivity even can correlate to the pain and he can complain of the pain. So if a child is having a mild sensitivity, that can be due to the exfoliation of the teeth. See, physiologic root resorption is something which is associated with the primary teeth. But root resorption is pathologic and it is related to caries when it comes to the permanent teeth. So in case of primary teeth, if there is pain or mobility which is not associated with the physiologic root resorption, so if the primary teeth is ready to exfoliate, that means the once the primary teeth or the milk teeth or the deciduous teeth, they shed, then the permanent teeth comes, right? So when the mobility which is related to the physiologic root resorption, which is quite normal for a primary teeth, but if the mobility is not related to the root, is not related to the physiologic root resorption, or say if the teeth is not ready to exfoliate, then the mobility can be related to or can be indicated for endodontic treatment. So if a child complains of pain, mobility, or if there is any fissure or abscess or radiolucency at the furcation areas, or if there is root resorption, so these can be some indications for an endodontic treatment for a child. One more thing, guys, is that say suppose this is a tooth, primary teeth. Say suppose this is a primary teeth and this is a permanent teeth. So if you see the difference between the primary and the permanent teeth again, so these primary teeth has got very high pulp horns, while compared to the permanent teeth, they don't have very high pulp horn, and the enamel and the dentine is thicker for the permanent teeth. So this is a permanent teeth. So guys, the primary teeth, when you are doing a restorative treatment, say, so there are high chances that we reach the pulp horn very easily. Sometimes we may injure the pulp horn while we are doing the restorative treatment. So if you have injured, say if you have reached the pulp by mistake, well, while you are making the cavity preparation, so that can be a chance in case of a primary teeth. Then also we have to go for an endodontic treatment for a child or for a primary teeth. So the highest pulp horn, which is asked frequently for the exams as well, is related to the mesiobuccal cusp of the first molar. So this is the primary teeth we are talking about. And because of this high pulp horns, that means there is more blood supply, right? So students sometimes they comment and they ask me that, ma'am, why direct pulp capping is contraindicated in the primary teeth? Students, you have to understand this, that since there is high pulp horn, pulp contains blood vessels, right? So because there are high pulp horn, that means there is increased blood supply. So if there is increased blood, that means the spread of infection can be more. That means the resorption also can be more. So there are high chances of having a resorption in case of a primary teeth. There are high chances of having infection in case of a primary teeth. So spread of infection is also high. The resorption is also high, and the repair is again, see guys, and repair also is high, because once repair also we need the bloods, right? So the repair process is more rapid in the primary teeth as well. So the previous concept was to put calcium hydroxide. This was the previous concept. Nowadays we use MTA. So calcium hydroxide, when it is placed over the pulp, say suppose this is the pulp. Now, once you place the calcium hydroxide over the pulp, say suppose this is the calcium hydroxide. So calcium hydroxide, it makes a barrier. It forms a barrier. How it forms a barrier? Beneath this layer, which is closer to the pulp, it contains the mesenchymal cells. So basically these mesenchymal cells, they differentiate and form the odontoblast in this particular area. Odontoblast activate the ALP enzyme. And this ALP enzyme basically is derived from the calcium which is coming from the blood. So here from the blood, guys, calcium is coming. So most oftenly there is a question which is asked that calcium, in the calcium hydroxide is coming from where, is derived from where? It is derived from the blood, and therefore it forms the reparative dentine. So basically calcium hydroxide forms the reparative dentine. And this is the reason that the calcium hydroxide is used in indirect pulp capping, right? So indirect, guys, what is the difference between indirect and direct pulp capping? Say suppose this is the pulp, then we have a tooth surface. Now what happens, say suppose there is a carious lesion, this is the carious lesion. Now this carious lesion, it is very 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 close to the pulp. Now once you are excavating this caries, if you are excavating these caries, there are high chances that you are going to reach the pulp. Now in indirect pulp capping, we are leaving the affected dentine, which we have already talked about in the previous lectures. So leaving the affected dentine behind, that means this dentine, we know that has got a reparative potential. This dentine can be remineralized again. So we are leaving this dentine, and this dentine forms the reparative dentine later on if we place the calcium hydroxide. So we place the calcium hydroxide over here, calcium hydroxide over here, and it forms the reparative dentine. So what we do is we take out this infected part. We take out the infected part, we prepare the cavity, we take out the infected part, leave the affected part. So this is what we have left, the affected part, and then we place the calcium hydroxide. This calcium hydroxide acts as a barrier and it forms the reparative dentine, and everything is restored. Now if it is done in the single step, it can be done in the single step, or it can be done in the two stages like that. So this is the indirect pulp capping, wherein you are going to leave some amount of affected dentine in the tooth itself. So with the help of excavator, say spoon excavator or hand instrument, you are slightly removing all the carious part, all the infected dentine, all the dentine which is soft. So you are going to remove this, excavator, then place a calcium hydroxide dressing. Now calcium hydroxide was a choice earlier. Nowadays we have, see, calcium hydroxide again can be used as an indirect pulp capping material. Also nowadays we use the resin modified GIC, which contains 5% of the resin modified GIC. So, and also bioceramics. So these are the modifications. And before the calcium hydroxide, there was the ZOE. So previously ZOE was used as an root canal filling material, like how we use gutta percha GP in permanent teeth, guys. We used to use this ZOE in case of the endodontic treatment for the primary teeth. See guys, otherwise MTA we use it, but in indirect pulp capping it is very difficult to handle the MTA. Therefore MTA is used as a direct pulp capping material, or say as a obturating material, I can say, in the rest of the procedure. So MTA is basically, it has got a very reparative potential, it is a very good material, but the handling is very difficult for MTA. So that is the reason MTA is not used in indirect pulp capping. So indirect pulp capping, guys, we are leaving some of the dentine. So the pulp, say suppose this is the pulp, this is the pulp, right? And then we are leaving some part on the dentine, and then we are placing this calcium hydroxide. How much dentine is away from the pulp is, we call it the RDT, which is the residual dentine. So if the residual dentine is 0.5 to 2 millimeters, then that means the prognosis is good. If the remaining residual dentine is, say, less than 0.5, that is 0.25 up till 0.5, then the prognosis is bad. And how do we check it? So we have a prepometer. Prepometer is basically an instrument which is placed over the dentine and it has got light indicator. So it tells us if green light is coming in that indicator, that means we have adequate remaining dentine. If orange light is coming, that means minimal. And if red means, red always means the danger. So that means we are reaching close to the pulp. So this is how we can also check that how much the remaining or the residual dentine we have. So this was about the indirect pulp capping. Like that, guys, we have the direct pulp capping. So direct pulp capping is, say this is the tooth surface, then we have got the pulp. So say this is the pulp. Now what happens, say suppose you were planning to do indirect pulp capping, but accidentally you expose some of the pulp. Say suppose you were making this cavity, preparing this cavity, and you have just exposed this pulp. So if you have exposed the pulp, so there is a pinpoint exposure, you can see, just touched. But that is a, again guys, that is a mechanical exposure, right? So with the help of a burr you have done this. So if this is a mechanical exposure, say less than or equal to 1 millimeter, or if there is a traumatic exposure, but the traumatic exposure is less than 24 hours, then we can do this direct pulp capping. Direct pulp capping. So if the caries has reached the pulp, then you have to go for the pulpotomy or the pulpectomy procedure. So but this direct pulp capping, guys, is contraindicated in the primary teeth. This is a very important point, guys. You have to remember this, that it is contraindicated in the primary teeth. So we do not do the direct pulp capping in the primary teeth, because calcium hydroxide, once it is placed in contact with the vital pulp tissues, there is a necrosis of the pulp. We see that there is a necrosis of the pulp, and eventually a barrier is formed. So from the blood it is taking the calcium, it is forming a barrier. After a month we see that there is increase in the thickness. Over some 1 year or something, you can even say it, see it radiographically. So but the pulp which is beneath the bridge is still vital and it is free of inflammatory cells, which is quite good for us. But what happens if we place this calcium hydroxide? There are chances of internal resorption, and in primary teeth, already the primary teeth is more prone to the resorption. So that is the reason that we do not use this direct pulp capping in primary teeth. That is the reason that the direct pulp capping is contraindicated for the primary teeth. So this is about the direct pulp capping. Now what happens if the caries has reached the pulp? Say suppose if the caries has reached the pulp, see this is the tooth, then we have the pulp. And if the caries has reached, say, invaded the pulp. Now if the caries has invaded only this much of the pulp, guys, then we can only remove partial part of the pulp. So there are two terms. One is pulpotomy, another one is pulpectomy. Ectomy word means complete removal. Always remember that ectomy means complete removal. So that is same like our root canal procedure. So complete removal of what? Complete removal of the pulp. Then we have otomy, means partial removal. Partial removal of the what? Of the pulp. So in case, say again we are making this tooth, so let's draw it again. Say this is the tooth surface, this is the tooth, right? This is the primary teeth. Now let's draw the pulp as well. So guys, this is the pulp. Say suppose this is the pulp. Now this is a tooth which is carious. Caries has invaded into the pulp. Now if you are removing the partial pulp, that means only the coronal part, so you call it the pulpotomy. That means you are leaving the radicular pulp and you are removing the coronal pulp, right? So that means you are removing the partial pulp. And if say one more example, let's take this is again a tooth, then we have the pulp, and if the caries has invaded into the pulp, say if you are removing the whole of the pulp and you are filling with the obturating material, so we have filled with the obturating material, that is complete removal of the pulp is we call the pulpectomy. Ectomy means always the complete removal. So we have completely removed the pulp and filled with the obturating material. This is known as pulpectomy. That means complete removal of the pulp and then fill it with the obturating material. Right. Now you understand the difference between pulpotomy and pulpectomy. I will tell you when both the procedures are done. When you have to remove partially, when you have to remove completely. Now one more thing is there, guys. Civac pulpotomy is there. So civac pulpotomy is there. One more term is there. We know that this is a pulpotomy. That means we are partially removing. Right. But in civac pulpotomy, you are not completely removing the coronal pulp. So say suppose again we have to take this tooth. Say suppose this is a primary teeth. And if you are removing, and say suppose this is some kind of pulp which is infected, say, or any exposure that we'll deal about it. So if you are removing only some of the pulp like this, so that is known as civac pulpotomy. That means partial removal of the pulp. So that is the civac pulpotomy. Now when all these procedures are done, in which tooth all these procedures are done, let's talk about right now. So guys, first of all you have to diagnose. Okay, let's talk about the primary teeth. Primary teeth, we do the indirect pulp capping, we do the pulpotomy, and we do the pulpectomy, right? Pulpectomy. In the permanent teeth, the endodontic procedures are indirect pulp capping you can do. You can also do the direct pulp capping, which is contraindicated in primary teeth. You can also do the civac pulpotomy. You can also do the root canal treatment, which is in primary, which is known as the pulpectomy, right? Pulpectomy. So, and you can also do the apexification and apexogenesis. So, apexogenesis is when you are forming the apex. Apexogenesis, genesis means forming the apex. Apexification, that means you are not regrowing the apex, you are just fixing it. So you are stopping the apex right there. So that is the difference between apexogenesis and apexification. So guys, if the duration of the say exposure, if less than 24 hours. So if there is a mechanical exposure say less than 24 hours, that means if there is a mechanical exposure, that means you have accidentally touched the burr in the pulp. So you can do the direct pulp capping, but again direct pulp capping is contraindicated in the primary teeth. You can also do the civac pulpotomy. Civac pulpotomy you can do up to 3 days guys, 74 hours, 72 hours. If there is a caries exposure, that means caries has invaded into the pulp, then you can do the pulpotomy or the pulpectomy. So how do you diagnose? We have heat test. In that, we put the heat stimulus. We have cold test, which is the best test for the vitality. I mean, among all these, then we put the cold Then we have the electric pulp testing. All these will be covered in the endodontic. So in that we apply the electrical stimulus. Then we have anesthetic and the test cavity. So pulp vitality, guys, we have two more tests. One is the pulse oximetry. Another one is the laser Doppler. These are the recent advancement. So guys, if you have seen something like this in the hospital, which is attached to the finger, which tells us about the pulse rate, about the oxygen saturation, right? So this is a oximeter. So this is the pulse oximeter. So this is basically a device which tells us about the oxygen saturation, right? Which tells about the pulse rate. All these things are there in this. And it's trending nowadays in the COVID, because it is very important that we record or we check the hemoglobin oxygen saturation, arterial hemoglobin saturation. So oxysensor is basically attached to a finger, to foot or to earlobe. Basically it has got a light emitting diode and the light detecting diode. It has got two diodes. One is the light emitting, another one is the light detecting. So light emitting diode, it has got two lights, two wavelength. One is the red, another one is the infrared. So this light emitting diode emits the light. Light detecting diode detects the light. See, as the name suggests, light emitting diode is going to emit the light. Two kind of light it emits. One is the red, another one is the infrared. Light detecting diode, it detects the light which is transmitted through the tissues back. So it detects the light. That is why light detecting diode. So there are two wavelength. One is the red, another one is the infrared. So the red one, it checks the oxygenated blood. Whereas infrared wavelength are absorbed by the deoxygenated hemoglobin. So both of these wavelengths, and then there is a device which process the percentage of the oxygenation of the hemoglobin, and this reading is come on the pulse oximeter. So this is the pulse oximeter. Guys, then we have the laser Doppler flowmetry. So laser Doppler flowmetry works on the Doppler principle. What is this principle? A light from a laser diode is basically incident, and then it is scattered by moving RBCs. So these RBCs are moving. This light is, as you can see, it is scattered by the moving RBCs, and this frequency of the moving RBC, frequency of the light is then broadened. So there is a photo current processor which measures the flow. So you can see this photo detector, it measures the flow, it tells us about the reading. So a laser light is transmitted basically to the dental pulp. So we have a probe, fiber optic probe. So this is a fiber optic probe. Which transmits the light in the teeth, guys. We have the pulp tissues, right? So say these are the pulp tissues. This pulp contains the blood vessels, RBCs. So this probe emits the laser light. This is the laser light. And then to the pulp, and there is a probe with a probe which is again touched to the tooth surface. So this probe is touched to the tooth surface, and then there are light beams, laser light beams, which records the moving RBCs. So the frequency of moving RBCs is recorded. It is signaled back to the probe, and then it is recorded. So this is the laser Doppler flowmetry. So basically it runs on the Doppler effect, so we record the moving RBC frequency. Which is our Doppler principle. So let's talk about the pulpotomy and the pulpectomy and what are the agents which are used in both of them. Starting with the pulpotomy, guys. Pulpotomy, we have studied that. It is the partial removal of the pulp. Now, if the coronal portion of the pulp is removed, we call it pulpotomy. And if there is partial removal of the coronal pulp is removed, then we call it the sivak pulpotomy. So, in case there is a carious exposure, say, in case there is a carious exposure, this is the pulp, and if there is a carious exposure, say this is a spread of the caries up till reaching the pulp. So what we do here in case of pulpotomy is that first of all we anesthetize the tooth, isolate with the rubber dam, and we remove the overhanging enamel and the dentinal caries. So first we remove the caries. We start removing the caries and then we remove the entire roof of the pulp chamber. So there is no overhanging dentine which is left. So it is usually a funnel shape which gives a nice access to the pulp. So like this, a funnel shape. And then we clean the pulp chamber and irrigate it with a water syringe. Then we moisten a cotton pallet, we moisten it and place it over the pulp stumps until there is a clot formation. So the most important agent or the most common agent which is recommended for a pulpotomy is the calcium hydroxide, which is used as an agent for a pulpotomy. And calcium hydroxide, guys, was given by Harman, which is again most frequently asked question. So this is the most commonly used agent for the pulpotomy, and we use it for primary as well as the permanent teeth. Both the teeth we do pulpotomy. So first of all, amputation of the coronal portion of the pulp, then we control the bleeding, control of the hemorrhage, then we cap the pulp with a calcium hydroxide, and then we seal it with a hard setting cement, and then we prepare the tooth, we give the crown. But in case if there is a hyperemic pulp, then we go for the root canal treatment. So hemorrhage control, guys, is done with a hemostat agent. And hemostat agent is usually a mummifying paste, which is our formocrisol. So formocrisol is the agent which we use in the cotton palate. Before applying the calcium hydroxide, guys, we use this formocrisol. So pulp chamber first of all is dried with a sterile cotton palate, and then we take the cotton palate, dip it into the 1:5 concentration of the formocrisol. So cotton, we take a cotton palate, then to stop the bleeding we take 1:5 concentration of formocrisol. So this formocrisol is a caustic agent, it burns. So we have to avoid any gingival contact with the formocrisol. So we have to be very careful. It's better that we use the rubber dam for all these procedures. So this 1:5 concentration of the formocrisol is what do we call? The Buckley's formula. Buckley's formula. What is Buckley's formula? This is tricrisol, 35%. Formaldehyde, 19%. Glycerol, 15%, and 31% is the water. Right. So this is the Buckley's formula. Now we take, guys, 1:5 dilution of the Buckley's formula. One is to five dilution means, so let me give you an example. Say suppose I tell that 1:10 students has passed the class test this time. That means out of 10, one student passed the exam. So how many have failed? That means 9 students have failed, right? So the same thing we are going to see for this 1:5 dilution. That means in this 1:5 dilution or 1:5 concentration, guys, we take this, that means we take this one part of the Buckley's formula, that means the Buckley's formocrisol, which is this one, which is tricrisol, formaldehyde, glycerol and water, and rest of the four parts we take. That means we are taking four parts, that means one part out of this, we are taking one part of glycerol and three parts of glycerin. We are taking three parts of glycerin and one part of water, distilled water. Right. So, let's start it again. First of all, we are making a Buckley's formula. So, we have a Buckley's formula in which there is tricrisol, which is 35%, in which there is formaldehyde 19%, in which there is glycerol and water, right? 15% and water. This is tricrisol is 35% and then water we have is 31%. We have this Buckley's formula. This is Buckley's formocrisol, say. Now we take this Buckley's formula and then we add, this is Buckley formocrisol plus we guys add three parts of glycerin. We take one part of this, three part, that means three times of this we are taking glycerin, and same as one part as Buckley's formula, we are taking one part of distilled water. So this is how we prepare 1:5 dilution of the hemostat, which we use it for the pulpotomy. So we take a cotton pallet, guys, we put this Buckley's formula in a cotton pallet, and then first of all, before doing that, the pulp chamber is dried, and then we take thick paste of hard set ZOE over the pulp stumps, and then we give the crown to the patient, prepare it. So how this formocrisol acts is that there are three zones. Formocrisol, basically this formocrisol act as hemostat, right? That means it stops the bleeding. So there are three zones when formocrisol is placed. One is the zone of fixation, so it forms a coagulative necrosis due to the formocrisol action. Then there is zone of atrophy, and then there is zone of inflammation. And in case if there is a, say, a furcation involvement, or in case there is a interradicular bone loss, then the pulpotomy is contraindicated. So if a patient complains of history of spontaneous pain, or if the tooth is non-vital, then also we cannot go for pulpotomy, then we have to go for pulpectomy. That means we have to complete remove the pulp. So we have to, that means we have to go for the root canal treatment in primary. So root canal treatment in primary is basically somewhat like the pulpectomy, but instead of gutta percha, we are using the obturating materials. So pulpotomy, there are other materials like calcium hydroxide, how are we used, right? We can also use, so many materials are there, guys. Like that we have formocrisol. So pulpotomy, what are the agents which can be used? Again, either the tooth is vital or non-vital. So if it is non-vital, then the pulpotomy agents are the formocrisol. Formocrisol or the beechwood crisol. Beechwood crisol. But if it is vital, then we have, again guys, we have three things. One is the devitalization. Another one is the preservation. Or we have regeneration. If it is regenerating, that means regrowth, regeneration. In the regeneration, guys, we use the bone morphogenetic proteins, BMPs. In the preservation, we use MTA. I told you that MTA act, functions as the preservation. We also have glutaraldehyde in this. So 2% solution of glutaraldehyde is what we use for 3 to 4 minutes. Then we have ferric sulfate. Ferric sulfate is still like in the research. So we do not use the ferric sulfate for a long period of time. We use it for like 2 to 5 seconds. The concentration which we use for ferric sulfate is 15.5%. Then guys, we have devitalization. In the devitalization, either you can do the pulpotomy in one sitting. So that is going to be a single sitting. That means only in single appointment you are doing it. It can be done using the materials like formocrisol or electrosurgery. So using the lasers like NDAG lasers or ERGIAG lasers. Then guys, we have two sitting. That means in two appointments we are finishing the pulpotomy procedure. So tooth stage, in that we use the Gaisi paste, Gaisi trio paste, or we use the paraformaldehyde. Right. So this is about the pulpotomy. Now pulpectomy is when we are completely removing. So in case of primary teeth wherein there is a necrosis of the pulp. Now we know that we cannot restore the pulp. We know that we have to remove it and fill it with a material. Which is, now you have to choose the material in primary tooth very wisely, because the primary root will undergo resorption before shedding, right? So because of that, you cannot use GP, because GP, see what happens guys. Say suppose if this is a teeth. Okay, and you fill this teeth with a GP, right? Gutta percha. Suppose this is an instance, we do not use gutta percha for the primary teeth. Now what will happen? Root resorption will happen for the primary teeth. But, root resorption will happen, right? Root will start resolving. Resorption will be there. But the gutta percha will still remain in the bone. So we want such a material that when the root resorption happens, the obturating material should undergo resorption as well. So we have to choose the obturating material. That is the reason that obturating material for the primary teeth are different from that of the permanent teeth. And earlier, previous days, we used to use this zinc oxide eugenol as the obturating material. Nowadays we also have so many obturating material like CMCP paste. So we have so many obturating materials which we use in the pulpectomy. So obturating materials in, we are talking about pulpectomy guys, complete removal. Pulpectomy, that means complete removal of the pulp. So what are the materials which we can use? To obturate, we can use the zinc oxide eugenol, We can also use calcium hydroxide, guys. We can also use the iodoform. We can also use Vitapex. So Vitapex is a combination of, you have to remember guys, VI, remember CI, like that. So CI is the calcium hydroxide plus I is the iodoform. Then we can also use the Volkoff's paste. So Volkoff's paste, you can remember it from PCM. I am having cold and teaching you, so I can just recall of the paracetamol. Also PCM, P for parachlorophenol, C we have got the camphor, M for we have is the menthol. So you can remember it, P, C and M. C, I is the calcium and iodoform. Then we have KRI paste. In the Volkoff paste, just add I. So IPCM, which is all this parachlorophenol, camphor, menthol. Along with that, we have iodoform. Iodoform. Then we also have miasto paste. So that you can remember it from the mnemonic, cotrimoxazole. So moxazole, so you can remember it, this is miasto. So MO is miasto paste. Then CO we have is the chlorophenol, and again we have two C's, another one is the camphor. Then guys, we have T is the thymol. Then we have ZO is the zinc oxide. Then we have L is our lanolin. So you can remember it, C is the chlorophenol, camphor, T thymol, M for miasto, ZO is zinc oxide, L is the lanolin. Then there are different methods of obturation, guys. We have different methods also of obturation. First one is the endodontic pressure syringe. In this, guys, what we do, we take a needle basically with the pressure. Say suppose this is the pulp. I should have made it from the red. This is the pulp canal. Okay, we have removed the pulp. Root canal. Say suppose this is the root canal. Now with a syringe, you take a syringe. This syringe, say suppose this is a needle. Right. This is a needle. Now what you do is, you place this needle 1 mm short of the apex. So this is, say that this is 1 millimeter. So you insert needle up till here. This is your needle. Below the, above the 1 millimeter. Short, 1 millimeter short of the apex. And then you slowly keep withdrawing it. You take the syringe up back. And after, like needle is, like after you turn the screw quarter, you withdraw it 3 millimeters. So you turn it quarter, withdraw 3 millimeter above, then turn quarter, then 3 millimeter above. You keep on filling this root canal with the help of this endodontic pressure syringe. Next one we have is the mechanical syringe. So mechanical syringe is somewhat like this endodontic pressure syringe only. It is like more like this syringe only, but the gauze, needle gauze of this syringe is 30 gauze needle. And along with that, we keep on pressing this and then withdrawing the syringe, taking the syringe up back from the root canal. Next one we have is the tuberculin syringe. This is also same like this, but it is 26 gauze needle. So this is a 3/8 needle syringe, inch syringe. Then we have Jiffy's tube. So Jiffy tube, in this guys we load the material by slow finger pressure. So we slowly apply the pressure on the plunger until we can see the canal is filled. Then we have incremental filling. That means we do the filling in increments. So in this guys we mix the filling material and then we prepare into a flame shape. So corresponding to the size and the shape of the canal, and we start tapping the material into it. So with the help of a plugger we tap the material and then fill the canal. Then we have the lentospiral technique. In this we take the lentospirals and then we mix the material. We take the lentospirals and then we fill the material with the help of these lentospirals. Start rotating in the canal until we fill all the canal with this. So these are few techniques, or we can say few methods of obturating material. What are the materials we have? Zinc oxide, eugenol, calcium hydroxide, iodoform, Vitapex. Then we have Volkoff paste, KRI paste, Miesto paste. So all these are the materials which are the obturating material for the pulpectomy. What is pulpectomy? It is the complete removal of the pulp, we say. So then guys we have the apexogenesis and the apexification. Apexogenesis is basically we do it in case of, so let's write it, in case of guys normal root development. So we have apexogenesis and apexification, right? So apexogenesis, as the name suggests, genesis means formation, apex means formation of the apex. Basically it is a physiologic process of the root development. Normal process, right? Genesis means forming. So physiological process of the root development. In case if there is a vital infected tooth. Tooth is still alive, tooth is still vital, but it is infected. In that case, where there is a very less inflammation present. So if we are doing say direct pulp capping, or in case of pulpotomy, we do this apexogenesis. So the normal root development takes place, right? In case of apexification, means we are fixing the apex. So this is development of the root apex in case of immature pulpless teeth. That means the tooth has undergone necrosis, pulpless, immature pulpless tooth, or you can say necrosed tooth. In case if there is a pulpal necrosis, now pulp has already damaged. You cannot fix the root now. What we have to do is we have to make a barrier so that the filling material does not go. Say suppose this is a tooth. Now the pulp has undergone necrosis. Whole of the pulp has undergone necrosis. It's already dead. But we still have the immature apex. As you can see, this is this is not completely formed apex. So in that case, you want this obturating material not to go inside the bone. So you basically fix it so that the obturating material is not going into the bone. So this is apexification. Apexogenesis is when you want the root formation to take place. So apexogenesis is vital tooth. So it is vital young permanent teeth, right? I'm just going to write vital. Then the apexification is when the tooth is non-vital. So this is the difference. So this is basically apexification is followed by a root canal treatment. But apexogenesis is followed by either indirect pulp capping or a pulpotomy procedure. So guys, this is the main difference between the apexogenesis and the apexification. So how this normal physiologic root development happens, there is a calcific barrier which is formed at the apex. So when the closure occurs, there is a calcific plug which is formed, and based on that there is a criteria which is the Frank's criteria. So the criteria 1 in the Frank's criteria is the normal closure of the apex. Closure of the apex. That means there is properly closure of the apex. Then criteria 2 is when there is closure of the apex, but the canal remains blunderbuss. Then the 3 criteria is when the barrier is formed at the apex and the canal remains blunderbuss. So you can see here a calcific barrier is formed, but the canal remains the blunderbuss. And the third one is the most common seen in the radiographs, guys. Fourth one is when barrier is formed, but it is short of the apex. So, say suppose it is formed short of the apex. You can see that the barrier is formed short of the apex. So, this was the normal one. It is short of the apex. So, this is about the Frank's criteria. And this is about the endodontic as well as the restorative part. I hope that you guys have enjoyed this video lecture. And if you have enjoyed this lecture, then give it a thumbs up. Also comment in the comment section below, because this motivates me to put more videos for you every day. And to make free notes which are available on the website, you can watch www.x2.com for more interesting notes like this. And the notes of this particular video will be provided in the description box below. The link is provided. And you can support me on Paytm as well as on PayPal to make free videos for you guys and to make free notes available. So till then, keep reading, keep learning, stay motivated. I'll see you soon in the next video.